Colossians chapter 1, Paul writes from incarceration, having gone to the temple, gone back under the law to impress Christian leaders out of his own ambition. God has now tied him down so he can do what he's supposed to be doing. It's a great blessing to be put in prison. And we should each and all be praying for that for ourselves. I see that you don't agree with that. I don't necessarily agree with it either. I just thought I'd get your attention. Paul writes in Colossians chapter 1, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God. That'll be our study. And Timothy, our brother. And of course, he's writing to those believers in Colossae and the saints and faithful believers in Christ who are at Colossae, grace to you and peace from God our Father. Now, Paul is emphasizing his apostleship. He had a great deal of conflict related to, is he an apostle or not? Those that the 12 disciples that walked with Jesus, minus one, Judas, and when the minus one came along, they decided they were going to replace Judas, and they voted. But problem with that, and I'm sure that these were wonderful men that had great ministries, but the problem with voting is that you can't vote a spiritual gift. You know, we don't all get to vote on who has the spiritual gift of apostle. So, this is Paul. Paul was, he said, he was appointed out of time. But he's emphasizing that by the will of God, and he does this five different times in different introductions so that he can emphasize the fact that God called him to this ministry. There was a great deal of question, and primarily because the Jews hated his guts. He was the one that God called upon to explain that Christ was the end of the law. They were in love with the law. They took shadow Christology. The law part was intended to teach man that he was a sinner. The sacrifices were to teach man the way of salvation. So you've got the law and the promises. The law, the rules and regulations were never intended to be a way of salvation. But of course, these good old boys, the Jews, they took these rules and turned them into a way of being saved, of being acceptable, if you keep the rules. Of course, nobody could, except Jesus Christ. So Paul says, the law has served its purpose. Christ has come. He has fulfilled it. It no longer applies. If it did, we'd be doing sacrifices even today. No longer applies. The Jews who'd been living under this for many years since Abraham really had a hard time letting go of that. Had a hard time letting go. So, this is where he is, and he's fighting these forces that would say, Paul, you're irrelevant. You're not appointed by anyone. So he says, my appointment is by the will of God. Now, he often felt compelled to remind his critics that his apostleship was by the will of God. His fellow Jewish believers felt compelled to criticize him for his stand on the grace of God as it applied to the Mosaic law and the gospel of Jesus Christ. Now, if you'll turn with me just for a second to 2 Corinthians 11, I'll just show you a couple of these to make sure that you get the point here. And the point is that you're going to be criticized. If you stand up for Christ, you're going to be criticized. You're going to be confronted, especially in this day and time. 2 Corinthians 11, 5. He says, for I consider myself not in the least inferior to the super apostles, or the most eminent, the most in the high places, you know, Peter and John, James, these guys who are the head knockers. He said, I'm not inferior to them. In fact, he's going to say another place, I did more of than all of them put together. I produced more for the Lord than all of them put together. He had a little issue with bragging, I think. Sort of like Trump, you know. For all the good stuff he does, he just wants to tell you all about it. In chapter 11, verse 22 through 28, he tells us about his suffering. He's comparing himself to these super apostles. Are they Hebrews? So am I. Are they Israelites? So am I. Are they descendants of Abraham? So am I. They servants of Christ? I speak as if insane. He says, I'm talking like I'm an insane person. Why am I having to explain myself to you? And he goes on and on about his suffering, which is incredible. Now, finally, if you'll go with me to Philippians 3 just for a second, and we'll pass this on. We'll get beyond this. But I want you to understand when he says an apostle by the will of God, this is on purpose. It's just not a careless statement that he makes. In Philippians chapter 3, this is where he's gone in Acts chapter 21 to Jerusalem when he should have gone to Rome. Now, when God arrested him in the temple and put him in prison, where did he end up? Rome, where he was supposed to go to begin with. This is the Jonah story of Paul. Look, Paul got swallowed by the whale of Rome, okay, and spit out, pooped out in Rome. And that's where he was supposed to be, just like Jonah got swallowed by the whale and ended up in Nineveh. So, in Philippians chapter 3, he talks about what got him there. And this is his old man baggage, his old man ambition, this worldly ambition that he had. He gives us his credentials. And he tells us all about it. He says in verse 7, but whatever things were gained to me, these things I have counted to be worthless for the sake of Christ. For more than that, I count all things to be worthless in view of the surpassing value of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. And he goes on. Point being that everything that led him into jail, he has now let go of. He learned his lesson. He let God burn it out of him. The suffering in your life, the adversities in your life, are perfectly designed to reveal to you that which God wants you to let go of. You understand that? It's not by accident. It's not just happenstance that you're struggling in these areas of your life. He has allowed this perfectly managed for you to boil out specific areas of wrong thinking, for you to look at that and realize that's wrong thinking. I'm going to throw that away. I'm going to go to the Bible, the Word of God, and I'm going to find the right thinking that applies to this area of life, and I'm going to apply that to me. That's how you grow. That's what he's doing. That's what he was doing with Paul. Now, let's talk about the will of God. Let's get to the will of God. If you will, look on your back page. Gosh, did that not get on here? I changed the notes. In the archives of the website, if you'll go to our website and search under category, you'll find the will of God. And there are four lessons that Ron did in 2013 called the basics. 2013 basics, and there's four lessons on the word of, on the will of God that are incredible. Everything you need to know about the will of God is in those four lessons. Okay? So you need to go bone up on that. You need to go listen to those, at least read the notes. It's really good. Now, first of all, when we talk about the will of God, we need to talk about the divine decree. Did you know that God knew everything that was going to happen before it happened? That's called foreknowledge. We call it the Eternal Life Conference. In eternity past, the Father, Son, and Spirit got together and had a conference. And this is all language of accommodation because we can't really understand somebody who's known everything forever. They didn't really have a conference, but we say it that way so you can get a grip on it. And they decide, they looked at all of the possible ways that human history could come about, and they decided the one we're living in is the one they wanted. They picked it out of all the other possible human histories that could exist, and they decreed it. And by decreeing it, God said, here's what I want human history to be. I declare this is what's going to happen. And everything that's happened, as God looks forward, we call it future history. History is us looking back. God sees history both the forward and the backward. The forward is just as clear to him as the backward is to us. Forward, back. He sees it all. That's called foreknowledge. This has been declared. It's been decreed. Now, his decree includes our free will. Some say that because God elected us and predestined us, that eliminates free will. They start right there and say, well, that must mean that nobody really gets to choose, that it's sort of a trick. You think you're getting to choose, but really it's God who's making you choose. Those are called Reformed theology. That's Reformed. And I don't agree with that. I don't think it's true. So when people try to emphasize the sovereignty of God to the point that it eliminates free will, I don't listen to that. Not at all. I believe God included free will, the ability to choose. The difficulty is that in a pre-salvation state, when you're spiritually dead, you can't understand spiritual things. So the Holy Spirit has to help you understand through the convicting ministry. He helps you understand the choice you're making. Everybody gets to choose whether they're going to be with God or they're going to be on their own. They're going to make it my way. If you try to make it my way, hey, buddy, you're going to be on the wrong highway. You know, there was a rock band that had a song called Highway to Hell. And if you don't go God's ways, you're on that highway. So, how you like those apples? In Ephesians, if you'll turn to Ephesians, we're right there. Ephesians 1, 4, and 5. Let's read this. I'm not making it up. I'm just not that smart. Anyone in my family will tell you and agree with that. I'm just not that smart. Ephesians 1, 4, and 5. He says, just as he chose us or elected us in him. Notice where we're chosen or elected. In him. Once you're in him through salvation, you become chosen. You don't get chosen and then put in him. That we've been chosen before the foundation of the world. What are we chosen for or to? That we should end up holy and blameless standing before him at the judgment seat of Christ. In love, or because of his love, he predetermined or predestined us to become adopted as his children through Jesus Christ to himself according to his kind intention, the kind intention of his will. So we've been chosen in Christ. When it's all said and done, we're going to stand before God holy and blameless. And he has predetermined that you and I will stand before Christ as one of his children. It was predetermined in the divine decree that anyone who trusted in Christ as Savior would become one of his children. In the same chapter, verse 9 says, and he made known to us the mystery of his will, church age, according to his good pleasure, which he purposed in Christ to be put into effect when the times will have reached their fulfillment. That's now. to bring all things in heaven and on earth together until one, under one head, even Christ. Well, that's anyway. In him we're also chosen, having been predestined according to his plan, who works out everything in conformity with the purpose of his will. He works out everything in your life, in my life, to conform to the purpose of his will. The purpose of his will was that Christ should be the first of many brethren. The purpose of his will is that all who will believe will be saved. That's the purpose of his will. That's why we give the gospel. God wants everybody to be saved. He offers everyone a chance to be saved. He enables everyone the ability to understand and choose to be saved. Anyone who will. Not anyone who's chosen. Anyone who will. Whosoever will. So, if you'll turn over, well, anyway, let's leave it there. He made known to us the mystery of his will. Now, his plan was decreed in eternity past, predetermining the outcome as historical reality. Y'all following this? It's decreed. It's playing out in human history as he saw it would happen. He declared, this is what I want to happen. It's playing out in human history, allowing us to choose, being able to account for all of our choices, staying way ahead of us all the way, allowing us to choose and having our provisions all out in front of us all the way down the line. Everything's laid out. It's all there. He saw it all ahead of time, and he laid everything we need all out in front of us, like fruit to be picked. The reason that we don't, quote, get what we need is because it's laying there, hanging on a tree, put there by God, and we just ignore it because it doesn't look like what we want. Or we don't think that God does that. He's not that interested in our daily life. That's ridiculous. You interested in your kid's daily life? Hardest thing in the world is let them go. Still want to micromanage their life when they're 32. Live on the other side of the world. Call them every day going, what you doing? That's stupid. That's a dumb decision. Don't you? And then you learn, you go, well, I better not say that anymore. Better quit trying to tell them what to do because they just don't listen anyway. I thank my dear friend Marion the other day saying, just save your breath. Just save your breath, you know. they just look at you and you can tell that they're somewhere, you know, playing frisbee golf or something. You know, they ain't listening to you. Now, God's plan was decreed. In Acts 3:18, he says, God announced beforehand by the prophets that the Christ would have to suffer. God saw it beforehand that this was going to be the plan. In 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 7, he says, God's hidden wisdom in a mystery before time, predestined for our glory. And Romans 8, 29 through 30 says that believers are predestined to become conformed to the image of his Son. Listen, predestination in a simple nutshell is that we would be adopted as children and be conformed to the image of Christ. That's what predestination is about. It's not that you were predetermined to become a believer by God's force. It's that once you did become a believer, you were going to be adopted as one of his children, and you were going to become just like his Son. When you stand before him in eternity, judgment seat of Christ, and everything is all taken care of. Rewards are given to you. You're going to be in a resurrection body like Jesus Christ. Perfect. That's predestination. That's what we're predestined for. Nothing else. No big mystery. I mean, it's clear to us that everyone who trusts in Christ is going to become that. Is it not clear to you? So, secondly, there are three wills that are operating in the universe today. God's will, we call it divine viewpoint. Satan's will, we call it cosmos diabolicus or evil thinking, and man's will, human will, we call this willpower. So, you got God's will going one way, Lucifer's will going another, and your human will is caught in the middle. And which way are you going to go? Not only for where you're going to spend eternity, you make one decision to believe that Jesus Christ paid your way through his death, burial, and resurrection. You make one decision and you're in, caught in God. Can't get out. But as a believer, you can still go contrary to God. Listen, all you got to do to go contrary to God is do nothing. Learn nothing, know nothing, and do nothing. Just be a good person and pretend you know you're a Christian, you know you're saved, you know you're secure, but that's all you know. You don't know anything else about the plan of God, the will of God, and you're not motivated to learn it. And when you're not, listen, you simply go the wrong way. It's your nature to go the wrong way. In order to go the right way, you have to make some decisions. You have to understand how that happens through the Word of God in the soul, in the heart, believed, functioning in life. Pray this morning that we not only be hearers, but doers. Doers of the Word. I want to be a doer of the Word. I want my life to reflect. Quite often it doesn't. I want my will to be aligned with God's. We're born into this life with our nature aligned with the devil's will. We eat on and feed on the worldly perspective until the day that we come to reject the world and trust only the Lord. Until then, we're eating on the world's perspective and buying into those views. I mean, there's so many people in our nation that have bought into this liberal point of view when it's just common sense stuff. So, three wills. Which will? You got one or two choices. Listen, you're human. Listen, the TV will tell you that human will can operate independently of God or the devil. Human will can operate independently, and that's just simply not true. You're gonna be influenced one way or the other. If you don't purposely pursue God, you will simply naturally let go, and the stream will carry you down with the devil. The flow will just carry you down. You have to go against the current to pursue God. You have to go against the current. Thirdly, there's three classifications under God's will. That's the directive will of God, what God specifically reveals about his decree related to you and me. This is what is God's will for my life. God's will for your life is found in his word. Here's the directive will of God. Husbands, love your wife. Let Christ love the church. Wives, submit to your husbands. That's the directive will of God. Don't forsake the assembling of yourself. That's the directive will of God. There's no question about those. I mean, you can't debate those. You can't argue those. Don't forsake the assembling of yourself unless. There's no unless. There's no unless there. If you're forsaking the assembly of yourself, then you are contrary to the will of God. Simple as that. There's the directive will, what God directs you to do in your life. Much of it's found in the Word. There will be a particular mission in your life based on your gift and many things that go into you having a specific mission. Then there's the permissive will, what God allows regarding your choices as you deal with the directive will. You get to choose many things as you move toward accomplishing the directive will. You get to choose many things. You get to use wisdom. as we discuss the will of God, this is what I believe. I believe that what God wants from us, for us, is to develop wisdom. Rather than God give us every little step to take, He wants us to grow into maturity and use wisdom to know the doors to go through and not go through. There are times you ask Him, He'll open and close them. That's clear guidance. But sometimes He wants you to decide and use wisdom to determine where you're going to go. This is, you know, when it's right or wrong, easy choices. Do I go to church or do I not go to church? Pretty simple, right or wrong. But when it's right or right, choices between right or better, that's where you have to have wisdom. You only get wisdom from the Word, growing in the Word, developing a edification system in your soul to have wisdom. Now, there's the overruling will of God, where God overrules your will. you try to go one way, and God says, not going to happen. Not going to happen. Jonah is a good example. Tried to run from the will of God. The farther he went, the bigger the storm got. Till those guys that were with him threw him overboard. We're done with you. And then the whale ate him. And in the middle of the whale, he prayed. And God gave him another shot. Peter was a good example of the overruling will. Peter, Jesus told Peter, you're going to deny me three times. Peter said, there is no way I will do that. So Peter tries to use his human courage to stand up against the forces of evil. Do you understand the forces of evil at play in that night? Jeez. Tremendous evil. And God, listen, a lot of times the overruling will, God will just simply let your own choices lead you to the humbling. He lets your own choices, it's what He did with Peter. He just let His own choices lead Him right to this point where He gave the third denial and He looked up and Jesus was looking right in His eyes. That got to break your heart right there. It broke His. He went out and wept bitterly, it says. So God overruled His choice. Listen, Peter wanted to stay hidden behind the mask that he had built in his life. I'm a big, bad, courageous man, loyal to the end. When in reality, he was a scared man, a frightened man, trying to do his best. And listen, his best, your best, his best is never the will of God. It's not your best or my best that God's after. God's after using the Spirit's power to overcome the world, to win spiritually. When you say, I'm doing my best, that's not necessarily the will of God. Your best is not what God's after. Now, that's a whole nother Bible class, or two, or three, or 100, but David is a great study in the overruling will of God. What God would have done had David trusted Him for the promise to make him king. Did you know that before he even met King Saul, that Samuel had said, you're going to be the next king of Israel. So when Saul comes to kill him, sends men to kill him, what can possibly happen? If he's allowed to kill him, God will raise him back up. If not, then God will simply not allow him to die. And he would have, look, the confrontation would have taken place right there by the will of God. Understand, David never had to run. Do you know David's story? Where he jumps out the window and runs and goes and eats the bread sacrificed to the Lord, ends up in the cave of Abdullah. Goes and pretends to be crazy. He does all kind of stupid stuff. Running from Saul when he never had to run from him in the first place. Listen, when you realize, you study David's life, just read 1 and 2 Samuel. We're in 1 Samuel on Wednesday night. If you read David's story, understand this. He never needed to run. He never needed to run. And everything that happened, everyone who died, every vow that was broken, everything that went on, none of that ever had to happen. It was all permissive will and overruling will. Fourthly, three categories under the directive will. These are never in conflict. They must all line up with the directive will. That's the geographical will. I believe that God has a place for you to be. I believe God has a church for you to belong to. I do. The Holy Spirit assigns spiritual gifts. He assigns your place in the body. This is not a personal choice. It's not, I like this place better. I like the music better here. I like this better. I like the way they do this. Look to the Lord and to the Holy Spirit and say, where do you want me? Where do you want me? Operational will is, what does God want me to do? How does He want me to function? According to the Word, according to the ethics of the Christian life. And finally, the mental will, what does God want me to believe and think? How does He want me to, what kind of attitude does He want me to have? This is probably the most important of all, because it's your attitude with which you do everything in life that reflects the Lord's presence. Fifthly, the difference between God's will and God's ways. If you'll turn to Isaiah 55 with me, I want to show you. This is really important for those of you who are seeking to walk with God. If you're not really seeking to walk with God, and that's not become an important thing in your life, then this won't really matter. Isaiah 55, started with verse 8. He says, my thoughts are not your thoughts. Neither are your ways my ways. See the difference between His thoughts, which is the Word, and His ways, which is the way He implements the Word in your life. The way God's ways have to do with your relationship with Him and how He leads you. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts higher than your thoughts. For as the rain and the snow come down from heaven and do not return without watering the earth and making it bear fruit and sprout and furnishing seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word be which comes forth from my mouth. It will not return to me empty without accomplishing what I sent it to do, and without succeeding in the matter for which I sent it. God's ways have to do with the way God leads you. Listen, here's how God leads you. There's quite often in your younger stages of the Christian life, before you understand that God will let you make choices that lead you into dead ends, He'll do those things so that you can learn to quit running ahead of Him. So you run ahead of the Lord, and the next thing you know, you're running into a brick wall. You run ahead of Him, and you think, why didn't you stop me? He said, well, why didn't you stop and listen? I had everything set up for you, but you're ready to go, huh? You ran out ahead of me. Peter, again, in his three denials, Christ warned him that he was going to do this. Now, you think after being with Jesus for 3 years, Peter would be willing to listen. Would you think? I don't want to put myself in his place too much, but it just flew in his face that the Lord said, "You're going to deny me." He said, there's no way. He just couldn't hear it. So rather than sit him down and force him, which he could have done, he could have forced him to admit that he didn't know what it was about to happen. He could have grabbed him by the scruff of the neck and said, "Stop thinking that you know." Instead, he let him live out his own idea until it reached and bore fruit in his life. Boom, the brick wall. You see that? That's God's ways. God has ways of teaching us. He lets us think what we're going to think. If we don't listen to the word and we don't get our soul straightened out so that we're going to think God's way and we're going to align our thoughts and ways with his thoughts and ways, he'll let us run around like a chicken with his head cut off, bumping into all these brick walls trying to teach us. That's his ways. Frank Baxter told me one time, he said, "God's a trickster." I don't know if I buy that. But his point was, God'll let things happen in your life you never dreamed that he would let happen. Sometimes you're thinking, "Oh, I'm coming back to Birmingham to go to school and get a job and everything's going to be great." And you think 13 years later, "Where's that job we were talking about, Lord?" And you go, "How did I get here? How did this happen?" He said, "You were just determined. You were just determined to go where you were going to go. You said everybody it was me." Of course it was. It was him. So listen, you don't learn these lessons, and I can't explain all these lessons to you. You learn these lessons about God's ways by walking with him. They're very personal. They're one-on-one. Now, finally, let's talk just briefly about discerning God's will. Lining up the Word of God with your own walk. And again, this is about wisdom. The more wisdom you have, the simpler this gets. The simpler it gets. God's will, first, God's will never contradicts clear statements in his word. For instance, he says in Malachi 2:16, "I hate divorce." And what does that tell you about divorce? God doesn't want you to divorce. Now, he says, secondly, there are exceptions. They're discussed in my word. In Matthew 5:32, "Don't divorce except for the case of adultery." There are other exceptions. If you're a woman who's in a marriage where you're getting beat up, don't stay in that. Don't stay in that. Don't get yourself beat up physically or your children. That's a personal opinion. Now, you just need to come and talk and find someone you trust to discuss and work these things out with. But I don't believe that God wants a woman to get beat up physically in a marriage. Now, thirdly, God always honors his promises. When God says, "I'm going to provide that which you need," you can trust that God's going to provide that which you need, even if it's beyond common sense. The hardest thing for believers to start living under the promise of God is it goes against what we think of as common sense, the American way. The American way is you go out and earn everything, and it's up to you. You've got to put look, that's divine establishment principles, and that's a wonderful thing to go out and work hard and accomplish and earn and build and develop. Those are wonderful things. But the promise of God has nothing to do with your efforts. It's unconditional. He's going to keep you alive to accomplish his will. even if his will for you is to be a bad example. You say, well, what's my purpose in the plan of God? Be a bad example? God says, well, keep him going. I need a lot of people to see a bad example. Wouldn't that be terrible? You get to heaven and go, well, what was your purpose in the plan of God? Now, to be an example of what not to be. Yeah, what an honorable role. God makes promises. The promises are always, the promises are your absolutes that you use to put the pieces of the puzzle together. The absolutes are always absolutely true. If he said it, you can count on it being that way to give you guidance. Don't go against it. Don't go against it. It is never God's will to violate his word or lead you to commit sin. Committing sin is never God's will. You can get what you need and do what you need to accomplish what he wants out of any situation without committing sin. Mental, verbal, overt. Never have to commit sin. That's one of your clues about the will of God. As you are eliminating different options and choices, you look at the promises. Those are the things you can count on. You look at the negatives. Am I going to have to do something wrong in order to accomplish this? Then the answer is no, I'm not doing that. Look, the will of God is somewhere else in the middle of this. Only those who've been trying to walk with him understand what's being said. There are right versus wrong situations, and there are right versus right situations that require wisdom to choose not only the right path, but the best path. For instance, the choice of a mate, people who are choosing someone to marry. There are many acceptable choices. All the Bible says is you got to have a believer to believer. But we know from common sense that there are not only acceptable choices, but better choices and lesser choices. Issues of compatibility. Issues of spiritual compatibility. One of the worst situations in the world is to be married to someone with whom you are not spiritually compatible. With someone who takes a different road in the spiritual life and is not interested in the same things you are, not hungry for God and the Word, more hungry for material things, relaxation time rather than ministry. You got two people going in two different directions, and that's going to be a difficult situation. Listen to the voice of the Spirit. You can study, we're going to study Samuel on Wednesday night, and you'll hear about that. And you put the puzzle together. Finding the will of God is like putting a puzzle together. Quite often, you're trying to figure out the different pieces and where it all goes, and you look at the promises, and you look at the negatives, and you look at the options that are still open. You listen to the Spirit, and the Lord will lead you, and you develop wisdom. The greatest thing to do is develop wisdom, and you develop wisdom by learning the Word. There's no other way. You learn the Word, and you walk the Word. Let's close. Let's have a prayer. We'll have a prayer and take the offering. Father, what a great privilege to hear about your will. I pray that you'll give us insight that we might do your will and not just know your will. First, we have to know it, and I pray that what we've said today will be helpful. You will translate and reorganize the discussion so that the believers here can understand what's being said, and that which is right will be put in their soul, and that which you don't promote or support, that you will remove it forever, and that we would understand and know your will, and then we would be inspired to do it. Pray for the offering today for those that give. What generous souls. I pray that we'd have no fear whatsoever of giving freely and generously, that we might not have enough. There's always going to be enough, Father, enough to give. So we pray that what we give today will be used and multiplied many times for the kingdom. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.